والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. So inshallah ta'ala, we continue with the sharh usul sunnah by Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani rahimahullah ta'ala. As everyone knows, inshallah ta'ala, maybe next week will be the last lesson, inshallah, because after that it will be Ramadan. And I'm planning to do something else in Ramadan. Probably be the biography of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, Sirat al-Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. So what I'm going to try to do, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to try to finish this risala by next week, inshallah ta'ala. So I'm going to read, and that which is needed to be explained, then I will read the explanation of the Sheikh. Maybe not everything, and that which is clear, we leave it, inshallah ta'ala. Then, because as I've mentioned, this is just a muqaddimah. You know, next time, inshallah ta'ala, we go through the risala again, but more in depth with the sharh of Ahl al-Ilm, different shuruhat, inshallah ta'ala. So the chapter of today, At-Tasleemu lil-Nusus al-Nabawiyya wal-Iman biha. At-Tasleem lil-Nusus al-Nabawiyya wal-Iman biha. Submitting to the prophetic narrations and believing in them. Believing in them. So the author, may Allah have mercy upon him, said, and whoever does not know the explanation of a particular hadith, or whose intellect does not allow him to understand it, then it is sufficient for him to simply submit and believe, because the matter has been perfected for him, such as the hadith of As-Sadiq al-Masduq, the truthful, the believed, describing the divine decree, and other prophetic narrations that deal with the divine decrees, or the Afwan decree. So the Sheikh mentions here, the Sheikh explains, Sheikh Rabi', concerning the statement of the author, and whoever does not know the explanation of a particular hadith, or whose intellect does not allow him to understand it, then it is sufficient for him to simply submit and believe, because the matter has been perfected for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah does not burden, Allah burdens not a person beyond his scope. Al-Baqarah. There might be certain texts that you do not understand the wisdom and the goal behind them, and what is the secret behind them. So it is a must that you believe in them, holding them to be truthful, because this is from the true faith, the true meaning of faith. Or the true meaning of faith, when you say, I believe in the unseen, I believe Muhammad is a true prophet, alayhi salatu wassalam, and the Quran is true, and that which Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam came with is truth, and likewise that he does not speak from his own desires. So that which you have knowledge of, then certainly the praise belongs to Allah alone, and that which you have not knowledge of, leave it to the one who knows, and you have been sufficed. So as you have mentioned before, my brothers and sisters, may Allah bless you all. Yes, our deen, no doubt, it goes in line with the sound reasoning, not just the universal sound reasoning. The pure sound reasoning that Allah created mankind with. The sound reasoning that which were has not been influenced by outside factors, by any philosophical ideologies and so on. For example, we mentioned the unseen has been divided into two. The unseen has been divided into two. The unseen, which the brain and the intellect, there's a room for it. Meaning that you, by utilizing your intellect, you can come to know about the unseen. And there's stuff unseen, there's no room for the intellect whatsoever. There's no room for the intellect whatsoever. And we have explained that before. For example, I have not seen the person who made the phone. So he's from what? From the unseen. I haven't seen him. Because the unseen, what does it mean? You haven't seen the person. We haven't seen the thing, the unseen. For example, the story of the prophets and messengers that happened in the past from the unseen. So that's from the unseen. I haven't seen the person who made the phone. But by analyzing and looking at the phone and reflecting upon the phone, I can see the person who made the phone must have knowledge how to make a phone. Must have a knowledge how to make a phone. Likewise, must have ability to make a phone. Likewise, must be very smart, because by looking to the phone, the structure of the phone, how it's been organized, programmed, connected. So I can come to know about this person, some of his attributes, even though I haven't seen him. But that's from the unseen. But the other part of the unseen, for example, there's no way for me looking just through onto the phone or reflecting and analyzing the phone, I can come to know if this person is bad to his parents or is good to his parents. That's a compliment. There's no room for your intellect to say, you know, by looking at the phone, you can see this person is very rude to his mother. There's no way to know that. You understand? And the best example belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So by looking at the creation, we can come to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the ability, wise, wisdom, and so on. But there are certain things we will never be able to know just based upon our intellect. Because not because we disregard the intellect, because the intellect knows, the sound intellect, sound reasoning, knows that it has a limit. And that that part of the unseen, there is no way for the intellect to know about it. Who can give us an example from our deen that there's no way for the intellect to know about it except by way of revelation? Yeah, that's true. The hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, there's paradise in details, yeah. But the ulama mentioned by the sound reason, you can see, when you reflect, you can see there must be a purpose and so on. But in details, yeah. Or angels. There's no way to know. Just by looking at the creation, there's angels. You know? Do you understand? Or by your way looking, Allah descends to the lowest heaven, the way befits His majesty. There's no room for the intellect. That's why we mentioned yesterday, as-sifatul khabariyah. Sifatul khabariyah is a sifat which there is no room for the intellect. So from that, some ahadith which you cannot comprehend, then you leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows what is the true meaning of it. Not because, I guess your sound reason, no, because your capacity of your understanding doesn't allow you to understand the hadith correctly. Because it doesn't mean you did not understand the hadith, therefore no one understands it. Do you understand that? Like for example, certain things in our life, we cannot understand. Like for example, if you bring someone to ask him how the traffic light works. If you say, I don't understand how it works, doesn't mean no one made it. Doesn't mean it's not being programmed, you know? Mean just your intellect doesn't have the capacity to understand the how it works. Because when we believe, because we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Almighty, and Prophet is the true prophet in the Quran, speech of Allah, based upon the clear cuts and the proofs and evidences from the intellectual proofs and the tangible proofs and so on, that Islam is the truth. And I've mentioned the example before. Sometimes you go to a GP, he gives you some medication. You think, why is this guy is giving me this type of medication? Why? And you cannot comprehend why. You know, or sometimes it's like, you know, this medication, take it at night, not during the day. And so he doesn't tell you why is the wisdom behind it, but you still believe and you take it because you are working with the ground of he's an expert. He's a doctor. He knows better than I do. You know, I'll tell you a funny story. Once, I was given an example about the doctor, yeah? So the guy told me, no, we don't trust doctors, Akhi. I said, brother, it's just an example, bro. It's not about trusting doctors or not. Just an example, bro. You're going too deep. You know, some people go too deep about it. Just an example. Now, like when a person gives you guideline how to utilize a phone, certain things you don't understand why he's saying to do this, not to do that. But you know, he's an expert and he knows about the phone better than you do. He's not you trust him or not. I didn't say go give him your money. So some people go too deep about some issues. So the shaykh, barakallahu feekum, we leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, from the belief of Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, Al-Imanu bi-Ru'yati Allah Jalla wa'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who see Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in Jannat al-Firdaus in a pleasure, in a manner that which is very pleasant and happy and so on. Because the Ru'yat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the usul of Ahl al-Sunnati wal-Jama'ah. And as such, the hadith that affirmed that Allah will be seen in the hereafter. You know, Allah will be seen in the hereafter. In the, it is mandatory upon the slave to have a firm belief that the believers will see Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا تدرك الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار وهو اللطيف الخبير. No vision can grasp him. But he grasp is his grasp is all is over all his all visions. He's the most high, subtle, and al-latif al-khabir, well acquainted with all things. Shaykh al-Islam rahimahullah ta'ala, may Allah have mercy upon him, said about this notion of the Mu'tazila that Allah does not praise himself by simply negating certain characteristics. Rather, he praises himself by negating certain characteristics and affirming others. And he mentioned a number of examples to express this point. For example, the statement of Allah, no vision can grasp him. In this verse is an affirmation that Allah will in fact be seen in the hereafter, because he does not negate that he will be seen. Na'am. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never negate that he will be seen on the day of judgment. He negates that the visions cannot grasp him. For example, you can see the sky. As Ibn Man came to Ibn Abbas and Arda, he said, you are able to see the meaning of the verse, Latul Absar. You can see the sky, but your eyes, your vision cannot encompass the sky and grasp the sky. طيب, ولله المثل الأعلى. And the best example and the loftiest example belong to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So from the Aqidah of Ahlusunnah wa Jama'ah, that we see Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَ وَزِيَادَ. As Allah said, for those who have done good is the best reward, meaning paradise, and even more. And it's been narrated that the noble prophet Muhammad ﷺ clarified the meaning of Allah's statement, and even more, and ziyada, saying that it refers to seeing Allah in the hereafter. That's the biggest and the greatest blessings, that you see Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the creator of everything, Jalla wa Ala. You know, that's a ni'mah. And more means to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am, so this is from the aqidah of Ahlusunnah al-Jama'ah, that to see Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And there's groups who negate that, the likes of al-Mu'tazila and al-Jahmiya, and other than from the deviated sects. But we're not going to go in details about those groups. We'll leave it, inshallah, for the next sharh that we do, inshallah ta'ala. And the author, may Allah have mercy, but he said, might find it difficult to fully fathom or understand or comprehend, or might sound very disturbing to the ears, but it's only upon you to have absolute faith in them, not rejecting one letter from any of these narrations or other than them, that have been reported by the reliable narrators, trustworthy narrators. So Sheikh Sheikh Rabi' mentions here will be troubling to the ears to those who have misguidance in their hearts, or to those who doesn't have the correct understanding. And some of them maybe will trouble them, but when you explain it to him the correct in the correct way, he will accept it. But Ahlusna wal Jama'ah, if what we say, Alhamdulillah, whatever Allah said is the truth. As Imam Shafi'i said, Amantu billahi ala muradillahi wa amantu bi rasulihi ala muradi rasulihi aw bi kalami rasulullah. So I believe in Allah and what he said according to the intent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I believe what Prophet said and according to his intent, what he meant, alayhi salatu wassalam. And as Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy upon him, my brothers and sisters in Islam, kitabahu, or kitabahu al-azim, dar'ah, ta'arud al-aqli wal-naql. Ta'arud al-aqli wal-naql. Repair in a way that the sound reasoning will never oppose the revelation. And he mentioned because sometimes the verse itself that the person thought is clear, but it's from the unclear verses, meaning have different meanings. So you think this verse is clear, that's what Allah meant. And then you think if Allah meant this, then it's opposing this scientific proven fact or something like that. The problem is not with Allah's speech, it's with your understanding. How many verses that people thought that's what he meant? But after when you go to tafsir, there's many, the ulama of the Salaf differ concerning the meaning of the verse. Barakallahu fikum. So, or sometimes what is so-called sound reasoning is not. It's an opinion. That's why Islam does not go and get sound reasoning. It goes and gets people's opinions. And people's opinions is based upon not sound reasoning. Any opinion that Islam go and gets, there's no doubt that opinion is based upon desires. And it corrupts the reasoning. Not a sound reasoning, which is universal sound reasoning, which Allah created mankind with. Now, likewise, the usul of Ahlusunnah wal-Jama'ah, tark al-jidal wal-khusumat fi al-deen, from the foundation of the Sunnah is not to debate or argue with anyone, and not even to learn argumentation, because indeed, disputing about the divine decree, seeing Allah, the Quran, other than that, from this aspect of the creed, is disliked and prohibited there. And anyone who takes on such behavior, even if he's right in his argumentation, he is not from the people of the Sunnah until he leaves off debating and submits to the narrations and believes in them. And we have explained this asl that has been mentioned before, that the ulama mentioned about debating, like Sheikh Sa'ad Sheikh mentioned, debating about certain aspects in the deen that none of you have dalil for. Was from the unseen. But for debating that to establish the truth, then as the Sheikh Rabi himself mentioned, it is something which is recommended. But as for debating for the sake of debating, wasting time, then that is not permissible. But to as Ajurri mentioned likewise, Ibn Battah, Rahimahu Ta'ala mentioned, if the debate establishes truth, or someone is spreading doubts and there's a lot of shabab, and so you debate with him to expose him and refute his arguments. Or Sheikh Rabi' mentioned, Hafidhu Ta'ala, if you're in a gathering and someone comes to charge you for debate in front of people, and you think, if I don't accept it, then the people think he's upon the truth, then you do it as long as you have knowledge. And certain things from the deen, there's no point to debate about. Because, like I said, the ulama mentioned, because both parties have no proof for it. From the unseen. You know? Like, some people talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, things that Allah never told us about. You know? And you see them debating hours. Or, what is a calamity sometimes? And this is the problem of philosophy. The problem of philosophy, that you see people debating what is known by necessities. And it's a mushkila. If you debate someone, for example, what is known by necessities, that it is impossible, irrational, illogical, It is no way whatsoever. Does not mean because we exist, we believe in it. No, even if it don't exist, that will not occur. That ma'doom or adam, non-existent thing, okay, to create something. If someone said to you, prove to me that cannot happen, he is majnoon. And you will be more majnoon for speaking to him more than 2 hours. You are more majnoon than him. For speaking to someone who thinks you have to prove to him that non-existent cannot bring something into existence. You understand that? If you speak to him for 2 hours, then you are more majnoon than him. Wallahi, خلاص لك مريض نعم you are well you need to, you also need to visit mental health care and you see that with the philosophers that's the problem of philosophy because what is the asa philosophy doubting everything is a lie that Muhammad Hijab is spreading philosophy means to use our sound reasoning that is not a philosophy because if the philosophers use their sound reasoning in the correct manner they would follow who prophets and the messengers Before Prophet Muhammad صلى الله وقالوا لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا في أصحاب السعير. They said if you only use our intellect, but philosophers, according to Muhammad Hijab, philosophy to use sound reasoning. According to him, they use the aql. So why Allah saying that? Because they did not use that. The sound reasoning according to its nature. Rather, they use the philosophy, the poisoned one. So don't lie to the Muslims by going to English dictionary, say, ah, that's what it means, what the meaning. No. No. Philosophy, firstly, this word is from the Greeks, the philosophers. So what it means, when you start doubting everything, and you have to prove everything. And if you do not prove what is known by necessity, they say, for example, if we're in a dialogue and discussions, and someone said to you, prove to me, non-existent cannot bring something into existence and I cannot create, bear in mind, it's a non-existent, doesn't exist whatsoever, in any shape or form, yeah? Prove to me, if you tell him, listen, brother, you need to go visit a hospital. Philosophers, according to them, you need to go visit a hospital, not them. Because you have, you should have done, try to debate about this issue. Try to go in details that prove to him, yes, you have to use your aql. You see, that's a calamity of philosophy. Huh? Surah Al-Mulkiyat, Tabarak, yeah. لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا في أصحاب السعير فاعترفوا بذنبهم فسحقا لأصحاب السعير Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they have accepted their sins and their mistakes and their error. What was their error? They didn't use the aql. But if philosophy using the aql, then they would have believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So philosophy, this is not what it means. Ya kadab. That's batil. Philosophy does not mean that. Using sound reasoning will lead you. If you use your sound reasoning in the correct way, the way Allah created, it goes in line with the Sharia Islamiyya. That's why Allah praised the Sahaba with Ulul Albab. And those who believe in Allah and His Messenger, Allah and His Messengers with Ulul Albab, people of sound reasoning, people of sound intellect, those who utilize the intellect in the correct manner. And that lead them to what? Believe in Allah Jalla wa Ala and His Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam. Understand that? As for philosophers, of the past and our time, no, you can't. You have to debate everything. You know, you have to debate everything, even that which is not by necessity. For example, that you have creator. No, even that you have debated and debated for hours. Well, you can give an example sometimes, but you cannot prove what is proven. They say the hardest thing to prove is the most obvious thing. You know, how are you going to prove to him, like, okay, the non-existent doesn't exist. And they say probabilities. There's probabilities. You know? But so there's probabilities for that, but there's no probabilities that this creation has creator. So you accept any silly and they'll be called what? Intellectual people. Because they accept these probabilities. I said to one of them, so it's possible that I'm dead in Algeria, in the grave. At the same time, I'm speaking to you in Australia. He said, yeah, it's possible. At the same time. I said, take care of yourself. He said, why, you cannot debate? He said to me, I cannot debate because I take care of yourself. You see, he's a philosopher. He studied philosophy, everything. So to him, he's going to look down on me because I don't want to speak to him anymore. To him, I'm a learned person. An uneducated person because I should debate more about this issue. Sheikh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah said to these type of people, either you take him to Sultan to lash him for him to wake up, or you do ruqya on him first. You need a ruqya. So don't be deceived by this kadda. So philosophy means to use a sound reasoning. But Allah said, about them, لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا في أصحاب السعير فاعترفوا بذنبهم فسحقا لأصحاب السعير. If we use our intellect. But according to this man, philosophy means to use sound reasoning to reflect upon the creation. No, philosophy is a corrupted method of using aql. That's why the Salaf warned against it. رحمهم الله تعالى. Al-Kalam, who are Al-Kalam? Al-Kalam is based upon falsafa. Tafalsuf and everything. Naam, so we mentioned that the us of Al-Bid'ah, I don't debate Al-Bid'ah at all. Except likewise, with exceptions. By the people of the book and the non-Muslims, us give them da'wah, and part of da'wah is debating. But there's two types of debate, a blameworthy debate and a praiseworthy debate. The praiseworthy debate, debate Allah has mentioned in the Quran, وَجِلَدِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنْ, and debate with them in a good manner. And the blameworthy one, the debate that is just waste of time or debating about something which is not by necessities. And for example, our time, my brothers and sisters, be aware of it. So this type of people I mentioned about, they will even tell you, debate me about non-existent. What proved to me that non-existent, Adam, you know, something which is, doesn't exist in any shape or form, proved to me cannot create something. These tough people, do you know what you should do to them? Move to second stage. And the second stage of speaking to them, by threatening them with Jahannam. Then fear Allah. Fear your creator. You're going to die and you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But to some type of Muslims, you know, that shows you weak in arguments. If you do that, means you are weak in arguments. Meaning that you don't have knowledge. You should not be given da'wah. No. Rather, you should carry on speaking to him. But this is a ta'na for Quran. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did not Allah threaten the kuffar of Quraysh with Jahannam? He threatened them. Ittaqun nar. Many verses. With Jahannam, with meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the Kuffar of Quraysh never believed in Jahannam. Because deep down they believe. And there's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates something within us. There's nothing that will wake up our fitrah except by utilizing psychological arguments, emotional arguments. To fear Allah, you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That can wake him up. Another way to wake him up. There's no more wasting time speaking to you about intellectual arguments. Because you need the threat. You know? But in our time, some Muslims say, "Ah, you know, look, let me tell." Like a brother brought to me, you know, the guy I was speaking to, the guy I told you, is it possible? I didn't mention this part. As he said to me, so I said to him, "Is it possible that I can be dead in the grave in Algeria, but at the same time I'm speaking to you? At the same time I'm standing, like in my form, not spiritual, like with my body, everything, in Australia?" He said, "Yes." There's another brother said, "Ah, no, I can't take him to speak. He's going to speak to someone else." Brother, this is, even for a Muslim who's alive, this person will not believe. If he has mentality, you know why? This person, Abu Jahl, he doesn't believe. He said it's possible for nothing to bring something. He doesn't want to believe. So some Muslims, even they will make, like one of the Mashaykh mentioned, some people, even there, by their speech, they can make a ton of the prophets and messengers. Why? Because prophets and messengers, they didn't know how to refute. Because Nabi Isa, he did not argue with them all the time. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reviewed the verses and he used to tell them, fear the day of judgment. But some Muslims now, nah, that shows you weak in arguments. You don't have to debate. Let me bring the philosopher so and so debate you. A'udhu billahi min al-khudlan. The best arguments and the strongest way of speaking and giving da'wah according to is in the Quran and the Sunnah al-Mustafa alayhi salatu salam. But some Muslims don't debate everything because that is a poison of philosophy. If I've spent hours to prove to you that a non-existent, no way for non-existent to bring something to existence because it does not exist whatsoever, then I'm Majnun, not you. If I spend hours, I have to go visit, have care, wal-iyadu billah. Allahumma sallim. So my brother and sisters, may Allah bless you all, we have to teach the Muslims that. Some Muslims, no, let me bring him. Yeah, sometimes maybe the brother doesn't have ilm, but certain people, they are summun bukmun umun fahum la yarji'un. Deaf and blind and dumb, and they will never return. Mean they're not believing. Regardless what you're going to tell him. Even they see mu'jizat. Some people, they saw the mu'jizat in front of them and did not believe. So what are you going to tell him? No, let me bring someone else to debate him. The mu'jizat, ya akhi, did not convince him. Miracles. Now at times they said, no, brother. You know what? No, I think he needs someone else to debate him. That's the calamity we're living in, wal-iyadu billah. And the outcome of this poison philosophy. And they say, you don't know philosophy. Yeah, miskin. You know. That's why, what they call it, the argument these people are using does not prove Allah exists as they themselves admitted openly. It proved necessary being. And that can be anything. So we don't know why it's philosophy. That's why it's important to study the books of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Likewise, from the Aqidah of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, Al-Quran, Kalam Allah, laysa bimakhluq. The Quran, the speech of Allah, is not created. Meaning, the wording and the meaning from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah spoke with it. Bis-sawti wal-harf, with a voice and letters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we say, remember, there's nothing like unto Allah in His essence, in His names, in His attributes, and His actions. Nothing like unto Him. So we accept, we believe. Because the Asha'ira, they say no. Because Asha'ira, they say, yeah, Quran is not created, speech of Allah. But, it's okay, akhi? They say it's speech of Allah, but you ask them, what do you mean by that? Because they say the meaning from Allah. And say, kalam al-nafsani. Kalam al-nafsani means Allah spoke with it from within. Who Allah created in the air and Jibreel saw it and conveyed it. No. Allah spoke with the Quran to Jibreel alayhi salam. Jibreel alayhi salam heard it and conveyed it to Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam. Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam heard it, memorized it, and conveyed it to the companions. The companions wrote it down. The Prophet sallam said, read it out to me, they read it out to him to make sure nothing is missing. Naam, so the Quran is speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is a sifa, is an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is an attribute. Okay, now there's two types of attributes. What are they? Dhatiya wa fi'liya. Ahsan takhi. Dhatiya wa fi'liya. And the third one? Combine the two. Ijma' al-ithnain. Dhatiya wa fi'liya. Yes, dhatiya wa fi'liya. For example, Allah's kalam is fi'li, sifatun fi'liya, also sifatun dhatiya. طيب الرحمة صفة فعلية likewise صفة ذاتية. So Allah's attribute is ذاتية, which connect to His essence, and that which connect to His will. Okay, and some of them both connect to His will and to essence. For example, and that's the best way to refute the Christians when they say to you, why the question is, Allah able to do all things? Of course, as a Muslim, we say yes. But of course, according to His wisdom, because we don't believe Allah just do things merely based upon His will, Mashi'ah, that's it. No, with hikmah, with wisdom, yeah? So they say, if Allah is able to do all things, why Allah cannot become a man? See what they did? They ask you about Allah's actions, then when you agreed with them, then they twisted it to Allah's essence. But Allah's essence, Allah does not change in a way. When we say Allah does not change, doesn't go against his nature to become imperfect. Okay? When we say does not change, means does not become imperfect, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because who Allah is perfect all the times, correct? Every time, all the times, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's perfect in his essence, in his names and attributes, and his actions all the times. So to say he become human being, that is a paradox, does not exist in the reality. Because human beings are created or not? They are created, correct? Allah is uncreated. So how someone is uncreated become created? That is irrational, illogical, impossible. Not because Allah cannot do it, because it doesn't make any sense to begin with. It's not a thing to begin with. Do you understand that? So if Allah become, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ تَعَالَى عُلُوًا كَبِنْ عَمَا يَقُلُ الظَّالِمُونَ. If Allah become human, where is human? Imperfect and created. They don't know. They're ignorant. Oh, this is when you become majnoon, you know? So, and what is a calamity? The Christians, they have the that's why when you speak to Christians and they try to criticize any Islamic legislation, say, listen, you as a Christian, you should accept any Islamic legislation. You should have no problem with any Islamic legislation. Because if your mind is able to grasp that God is perfect all the times, is uncreated, and he has no beginning, but at the same time he became created, and he had a beginning, and you accept that, therefore the aql that you have can accept anything. Can accept any Islamic legislation. Because you already accept the most illogical, irrational, impossible, nonsensical thing, then you accept anything else. Let alone something make sense. Do you understand this point? That was very important when you speak to someone last week in Speaker's Corner. Someone came to me about the sun setting. I said, do you accept anything? You should accept anything about Islamic legislation. You have nothing to stand against the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Your brain accepts the most irrational, illogical, doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Like, I don't know what you've been drinking.
Even the guy with the washing machine.
The wash machine guy, Wallahi, I don't know which machine had it. You know, the guy said to me, it's possible that you, if you keep washing your clothes, scientists say, because he tried to prove there is no creator. So if you keep washing your clothes over and over and over and over and over, then infinite time, which doesn't make any sense, because how is infinite time? You haven't even lived. Then what happened? You have your clothes dried and folded in a perfect manner. So you have trousers folded, and a shirt, and t-shirt. So the way I was looking at him, people were thinking, what Shamsi was thinking. I was thinking, is this man serious? Is he taking a make out of me? Is he mocking me? You know, is he mocking me, this individual? Then I said that to him, you know, literally, and he's taking it serious, you know. The guy is serious. That I said to him, look, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. So the sifatul dhatiyya, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke with the Quran. Likewise, Allah spoke with the Torah. Likewise, Allah spoke with the Injil. Likewise, Allah spoke with the Zabur and other scriptures which we don't know of. And Allah said, وَإِذْ نَادَ رَبُّكَ. And when your Lord called out to Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam. So the Quran is a speech of Allah. Is not created. You know, if someone asks you, the Mus'haf, if I imagine this is the Mus'haf, and I ask you, this Mus'haf is it created or not? Huh? Yeah, just don't say yes or not. You ask. Say, what do you mean by that? What is on the Mus'haf? Or you mean the paper and and the ink? You see? Because the paper and the ink has been utilized as a means to convey the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that doesn't mean the speech of Allah became the ink and the paper. You understand? Allah's speech didn't leave him. It's an attribute of his subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is exists within himself, tabaraka wa ta'ala. So when someone asks you, is a mushaf created or not? Say, what do you mean by that mushaf? You're talking what is in the mushaf? The speech on the mushaf is not created, speech of Allah. But we're talking about the ink and the paper that has been utilized, that is created. Do you understand that? So you have to be careful when you answer a question. And they say one of the miracles of the Quran, that the Quran, as At-Tahawi said, rahimahu ta'ala, is not the speech of Al-Bashar. Na'am, he's not speech of al-Bashar. That's one of the miracles of the Quran he mentioned. Why he said he's not speech of human beings? Because, you know, for example, Sheikh Sahih Sheikh Mansh Hafidahullah Ta'ala, Na'am al-Wazir, he said, you know, there's some people, you can know which country they're from. Say he's from India, he's from the Caribbean, he's from Africa, he's from Australia. You know, there's attribute, physical attribute, which can differentiate them. Sahih? Likewise, when you hear the speech of Allah and you listen to human beings' speech, clearly that the Quran is not speech of human beings. Like which human start with Taha, ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'ana litashqa illa tadhkiratan liman yakhsha unun wal qalam wa ma yasturun ma anta bi ni'mati rabbika bimajnun wa inna laka la ajran ghayra mamnun or ar-rahman 'allama al-Qur'an khalaqa al-insan 'allamahu al-bayan wa kaf ha ya 'ain sad dhikru rahmati rabbika 'abduhu zakariya إذ نادى ربه نداء خفيا قال ربي إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا ولم أكن بدعائك ربي شقيا Oh, the other verse, الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم والطور وكتاب مسطور في رق منشور These know him. Have you heard him speak like that? That's you know. Just listening to the Quran, you can know this is not human speech. That's one of the ulama of tafsir, when he wrote tafsir of the Quran, so he did not put brackets to differentiate between his speech and the Quran speech. So one of the talab said to him, yeah, Shaykh, you should have put brackets to differentiate. He said, no, because my speech is clear and Allah's speech is clear. He said, the people that will get confused between my speech and Allah's speech, they're ignorant. I don't have to do that because it's clear. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran is speech of Allah Jalla wa Ala. So the Quran is a speech of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And the Quran was revealed. Another fa'idah we can. The Quran, and before that, for indeed Allah's speech is from Him, not separate from Him. And nothing of Allah's attribute or His speech is created. Also be cautious of debating with anyone who has innovated concerning this. Now this again, these affairs, be careful. Again, we mentioned about the conditions of debate and so on. The shahid, the Quran was revealed in a different ways. Ala sab'ati ahruf. Different ways of reciting the Quran. And to be sure, you know, there's many examples from the time of Sahaba to show you Quran is not, no one can change the Quran. You know, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. If you say رب الحمد لرب العالمين الله it's correct, in a way it's correct. Shu'ala mentioned that. But if you recite it this way, you're wrong. Even though correct, the meaning is correct. No, why? Why are you not allowed to say it like that? Even though the meaning is correct, by the way. Why? Why are you not allowed to say it that? Because the Quran is tawqifi. The way you recite it is tawqifi. That's why you're not allowed to convey the Quran with the meaning. I mean, you cannot say Allah meant this. No, either you say the madmoon or the explanation of the Quran. Don't say Allah said and you mention the meaning. You say the meaning of this verse. I can't remember, but the ulama said this. But when it comes to hadith, you allow it to know the hadith with the ma'na, with the meaning. Look, subhanallah, because the Quran is tawqifi. You don't have Christians, don't have that. Christians, no way, I'm saying. And the calamity that sometimes you want to just think, are you serious? That you try to compare the Quran to the Bible. From time of Sahaba, no one is allowed. The hadith, there's some hadith, was narrated by the meaning, and some ulama said it's accepted. No problem with the meaning, as long as you convey the correct meaning. Yeah? But when it comes to the Quran, no. You have to convey it with the wordings. The way Allah revealed it to His Prophet, alayhi salam. Subhanallah. Even there's some verses, they came to Uthman ibn Affan. They say, yeah, Uthman, this verse has been abrogated. He said, okay, the ruling has been abrogated, but the verse has not been abrogated. So they said to him, someone said, so what is the point? He said, because it's tawqifi, we leave it. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never said remove it, we leave it. Subhanallah. To show you they were very cautious and precise. That's why the scholars of Quran, they sit in the masjid for 40 years. And the calamity, we say Chinese whisper. Please, first is a Chinese whisper, is a whisper. It's a whisper. So no one heard it except you. You see, Quran is no whisper. Quran has been revealed, recited openly. Secondly, you have to read it out for 30 years or 15 years or 10 years. Thirdly, Quran was easy, made easy to be memorized. So this Chinese whisper is a joke thing that you try to compare to Quran. It's a whisper to begin with. And that's why the qira'at, to prove that Quran has not been changed, the qira'at that we have, like for example, qira'at warsh, if you go to Algeria or you go to Pakistan, it's the same qira'at warsh. Qira'at hafs, you go to Algeria or Morocco or Pakistan, you go to countries like you go to India, or you go to Saudi, Kuwait, it's the same one. And we mentioned about also anyone who says his recitation is created or other than this, and whoever hesitates in this matter and says, I do not know whether it's created or not. I don't know if it's created or not created. So here he's mentioning, be aware of this type of people. Those who say, my recitation is created. The Salaf won't guess it. Because what do you mean by your recitation? Again, look, subhanAllah, to be precise. What do you mean by that? Your voice? Or you mean the Quran? Because it can be both. So, the Salaf won't guess this ambiguous. Mutashabih, kalam al-mutashabih. So, if you, that's why they say, al-kalamu, kalamu al-bari, was-sawtu, sawtu al-qari. The speech, is speech of Allah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and the voice is the voice of Bani Adam, the human being, the reciter. Or someone says, I don't know if it's created or not. Be aware of this person. However, be aware of someone bringing you a statement. Imam Ahmed said this before. Imam Ahmed, rahmahu ta'ala, as the ulama mentioned, in the beginning he said that. He said, someone asked him, he said, don't say create or not. He didn't say, I don't know. He said, don't say. Sorry, he didn't say, I don't know. He said, don't say it's create or not. Sheikh Salah al-Sheikh, rahmahu ta'ala, said, the reason being because that time, there was no need to clarify that. Why are you going to start this problem? It's not needed. No one speaks about it. But when the people start saying it's created, that's when the Salaf had to stand firm and clarify the correct stance towards the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, that's why some of the speech of Salaf, early Salaf, they didn't want to speak about this issue. Because why? Why you want to start this? No one really speaks about it. Why you want to start about speaking about it? Do you understand that? So if someone comes to you and says, Imam Ahmed said that? No. Don't let him deceive you. Say, na'am, that is in the beginning. But when the fitna started, and let's ask, because he said, if someone say create or not, said, don't speak about it. Don't speak about it. Leave it. It is just the speech of Allah, this person. And if he says, I don't know if it's create or not, it's a speech of Allah. This person has fallen into innovation. And it's just like the one who says, if the Quran is created, but the Quran is the uncreated speech of Allah. Because now is a time of what? Of tibyan. That's why the Salaf also, they didn't like to ask questions about matter that doesn't exist. You know? They didn't like it. That's why some books of fiqh, Salaf didn't like some issues being mentioned in those books. Because it doesn't really happen. Why are you speaking about it? Now, for example, man goes to the grave or before he buries his wife, that's mentioned in books of fiqh. Before he buries his wife, she's dead. And if he have intercourse with her, should he be lashed or he should not be lashed? So some of Malahid and other than them say, look, in Islam you believe it's halal. No, this faqih is speaking about it. You know, but Salaf dislike this stuff. Why are you speaking about it? It doesn't happen. No, that's not permissible. Eh? Even if you have intercourse with dead. نعم. Likewise, the Iman will be رؤية الأفضل آخرة. He mentioned that again. To believe that Allah will be seen on Day of Judgment, as it has been narrated on the Prophet Muhammad in the authentic prophetic narrations us to believe that Prophet Muhammad saw his Lord, for indeed it has been authentically narrated the authority of Ibn Abbas, also Al-Hakam bin Ibban reported that this on the authority of Ikrimah, who reported it on Ibn Abbas. Also Ali ibn Zayd reported on Yusuf ibn Mihran, who reported this on Ibn Abbas. We understand this hadith on its apparent meaning as it comes reported on the Prophet ﷺ. To speak about this affair using theoretical rhetoric is an innovation, but rather we believe in its apparent meaning as it has been reported, and we do not debate anyone pertaining to this affair. So again, the author, I mentioned this issue of Ru'yat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah, the Messenger of Allah. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, so he said to believe that Allah will be seen on the day of judgment as it has been narrated on the Prophet Muhammad alayhi wasalam, authentic prophetic narrations. A difference of opinion occurred pertaining to this issue. Did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam see his Lord the night of Isra or not? Many people attach themselves to the statement of Ibn Abbas as well as the statement of Imam Ahmed, deriving the understanding of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw his Lord with his two eyes. So the Yom al-Isra wal Mi'raj. Okay. So Isra, what is Isra? What is al-Isra? Isra, when Prophet was taken from Mecca to Masjid Al-Aqsa, نعم. That al-Isra. Al-Mi'raj, عندما عرج به. Mi'raj, when he was taken from Masjid Al-Aqsa to the seventh heaven. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا. Until the end of the verses. This was Isra. That Allah prayed, glorified himself for taking his servant from Al-Aqsa to to Mecca to Masjid Al-Aqsa. And the other verse, which is Al-Mi'raj, in Surah Al-Najm. In Surah Al-Najm. So Ibn Abbas, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahu ta'ala said, the statement of Imam Ahmed and the statement of Ibn Abbas are reported general and restricted. And restricted, meaning it is reported generally that Ibn Abbas said that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw his Lord. And it's also reported from him as well as that he radiallahu anhu saw his Lord with his heart. Likewise, it has been narrated on the authority of Imam Ahmed that Prophet Muhammad wasalam, saw his Lord with his eyes. And there are other narrations from Imam Ahmed that indicate the Prophet wasalam, saw his Lord with his heart. The correct opinion is that which Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahu ta'ala mentioned. It is not in the book of Allah nor in the authentic Sunnah that the Messenger of Allah saw his Lord with his eyes. Rather, the statement of Ibn Abbas is discontinued and does not connect directly to the Prophet wasalam, and at the same time it is restricted, and the restricted texts that have come are more authentic. In Sahih Muslim, it is reported that Prophet saw his Lord with his heart twice. So that's the correct one. They differed with his eyes or with his heart, but rather what specified these other narrations or the other narrations that he saw his Lord with his heart. As Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said, مَا كَذَبَ الْفُؤَادُ مَا رَأَى. The Prophet's heart lied not in what he saw. وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى. And indeed, he, alayhi salatu wa salam, Muhammad, saw him at a second descent. I mean, another time. Inshallah, we'll stop here and we continue next week, inshallah ta'ala, with the rest of, as I've mentioned, we will try to finish with this risala next week, inshallah ta'ala, and we will start it after Ramadan again, more with the shuruh, and we go more in depth, inshallah ta'ala. Barakallahu feekum, jazakum Allahu khayra, to give you time to make wudu, because the time for Isha is 8 o'clock. We have 10 minutes left. Inshallah ta'ala. And before, yeah, na'am, let's have this 10 minutes. I have some books. I have Arabic books as well. I have this book, Ta'sis al-Ahkam. ما صح عن خير الأنام بشرح أحاديث عمدة الأحكام. And we have other books as well. It's a gift. You know, let me ask questions. This, how many volumes here? Five volumes. By Sheikh Imam Al-Allama Ahmed bin Yahya Al-Najmi. And the first volume checked by Imam Al-Albani. So the first question, but raise your hand, please. Yeah. Yeah, don't answer straight away. If you answer straight away, we're going to kick you out. No, they're going to be in the camera and say, look, some CC kicks out people from the masjid. He's a liar. Kadib. I have never kicked someone out of the masjid except one person. He was coming to masjid and he was known to cause mashakil in the masjid. He was known to bring, and I never kicked him out, alhamdulillah. I told him, listen, you are welcome to come to pray. There is a bait of Allah, it's not my bait. But if you keep coming to cause trouble, stop. People are complaining about you causing trouble. You come in to bring doubt and guess al-sunnah al-jama'ah, then you're more than welcome to come pray. Even we had some takfiri, he never used to pray behind me. And he used to come, first prayer. While I'm leading, he prays by himself. So I said, look, you are more than welcome to come to the masjid. However, you cannot pray while we're praying jama'ah. You're causing a problem. Big takfiri guy. You know, he said, Sheikh Mamba is kafir. You know, so these people are lying against us that we kick people out of masjid. Kadib! Wallahi. Anyway, the question is, there's three types of Allah sifat. There's three types of Allah sifat. This, by the way, is in Arabic. So if you don't know how to read Arabic, maybe you can take it still until you learn. Sahih, sifatun dhatiyah of ayat for you. MashaAllah, this five volumes. MashaAllah. Khalas, the second question we have, so we have books of Adda' wa Dawa' and we have Shah Usul Sunnah. طيب, second question I'll be asking, by raise your hand, if someone asks you, but I don't know if you live in Spain, I'm going to send it to you, in a bird, pigeon is going to come to it, barakallahu alaykum, that's a blessing coming to masjid, you see, alhamdulillah, we don't give shoes here, we don't give trainers, you know, we give books, ilm, because masjid is not a house phraser here, like some people, we make a masjid debate of Allah, house phraser. He's giving shoes, he's giving bags. No, we give books, ilm. Alhamdulillah, but Allah's tawfiq. So, come next time, come, inshallah. We have books for you. Inshallah, afwan, I don't know how we're going to send it. You know, it's a mushkila. So, the second question. Name one teacher of Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahu ta'ala. If you want to raise your hand there. He raised the first. Okay, another question then. What year was he born? Ibn Taymiyyah. He was born 728. He died 728. He was born 661. The second question, okay, for the sisters, maybe they're not participate as well, but you have to write it down. Okay, the second question. So for the sisters, mention the four ways or the four pillars of Al-Qadr. The four pillars of Al-Qadr. Now, this is the question for the sisters. The question for the ikhwa. What is the kunya of Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyya? His kunya. No, you answered already. Yeah, someone hasn't answered. Where is kunya? His nickname. I'm not talking about the kunya Abu Abdullah, because Abu Abdullah. No, he had another nickname. What was his name? Because I think people were thinking that was his name. Some of you maybe know. What was his name? Yeah, na'am, sahih. So you asked the question correctly, so tell us which book you want. You can send the write on the paper, inshallah. His name, his nickname, Shamsuddin. It's Shamsuddin, that's not his name, his nickname. So I'll take the book then. Okay. Give another question. This. Yeah, there is Da'wah al-Dawah, so there's two books. There is a Da'wah al-Dawah, the disease and the cure, and Sharh Usul al-Sunnah, an explanation of Imam Ahmed, foundation of the Sunnah. Okay. Disease and the cure. Barakallah. And make dua for the brother who gave it to us. Brother bought them for us to give them as a. Give us one proof that for the brothers, one proof that the believers will see their Lord on the day of judgment. You come late, my brother. Because you raised your hand. If you translate it, please.
Some faces on that day will be brightened, looking to their Lord.
Barakallah. Which book you want? All right. Another question for the akhawat to be just, you know. Okay, the other question for the akhawat. You know, to tell you this funny story. He said there is a man, a teacher. He had two boys to do exam with. So one boy, his father was very, very rich. You know, very rich. And the other boy's father was very poor. So every time he asked the boy whose father is rich, he asked him the simple question that everyone knows, even the ignorant. When it comes to the other boy, ask him Hitler, which day was born, and what food he used to eat. Just for the boy to win. So some people, subhanAllah, they make it very hard. So this is the question for the akhawat. Because I don't want to say people are making it easy. I'm making it easy for the akhawat, yeah? What is the... Let me see. I'm going to ask the questions about... Okay, the question, what is a sunnah? For the sisters, what is a sunnah? The legislative ta'rif, not lughat, lughat and sunnah mean a way. By definition, according to al-hadith, we mentioned it many times, I believe. What is a sunnah? For the brothers, the question that I will ask. Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah ta'ala. Everyone know Sufyan al-Thawri? Something happened to Sufyan al-Thawri that made him run away from al-Kufa. Let me see if you read biographies of the ulama, al-Salaf. Something happened to Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah ta'ala, that made him run away from al-Kufa. No, not this one. Not this one. Something happened to Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahu ta'ala that made him run away. And he was working for someone in the garden. The way of the Prophet, action and speech. Okay, this is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, action, speech, and manners. Naqis, the answer is not complete. Sunnah is the say and action and the approval. Huh? Tavu, yeah, approval, yeah. But that is not as well. There's something missing. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah is the action. And the speech and the approval sunnah, and likewise his manners, likewise his physical characteristics. ما ما نسب النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام من قول وفعل وعمل وقول وفعل وإقرار وخلق وأخلاق. So the answer is not correct. No. Another book for me. What was the question of Abbas bin Thawri? Okay, Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahu ta'ala, I think I'm going to take the books all of them, khalas. And give. Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahu ta'ala, he had to run away from the Kufa because Abu Ja'far al-Mansur, the Khalifa al-Abbasi, told him, yes, Sufyan, you have to be the Qadi, the judge in Kufa. He said, yeah, I mean, I cannot do it. He said, but Allah, if you do not do it, I will cut off your head right now. He said, you have to be the judge. He said, yeah, I mean, let me go get the garment of the judges, all that. He said, okay, go. When he let him go, he ran away. So he ran away to a place outside of Kufa. And he was working, so he had no money. He said to the person, let me work in your bustan, in your garden. And his garden had many trees of grapes and so on. So he said to him, yeah, so and so. He said, Abdul, he said, what is your name? He said, my name is Abdullah. He said, because the Khalifa heard that Sufyan al-Thawri had run away. So he said, anyone that bring Sufyan al-Thawri back, I will give him money. Hayyan aw maytan, dead or life. So Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahu ta'ala, the owner asked him, he said, yes, Abdullah, what is your name? He said, my name is Abdullah. He said, yeah, Abdullah, what do you think about the food, that the fruit in my garden? Is it my grapes is better or the grapes of Al-Kufa? He said, I have not tasted your grapes, yeah. Sir, he said to him, no. He said, no one in this town except have tasted my grapes. Old, young, rich, poor, everyone. He said, no, I haven't. He said, because you never give me the permission. He said to him, are you pretending to be Sufyan al-Thawri now? You're telling me that no one, you haven't not. He said, no one lie. He said, okay. So he went back to his friend, this person, the owner of the garden. He went back to his friend and he said, can you believe it? I have a worker in my garden who told me that he's been working for a long time in my garden and he told me he never tasted the fruit. He said, tell me, how does he look? So he started telling him, he said, this is Sufyan al-Thawri that the Khalifa is looking for him. So they went to get him, but they found him gone because he knew. So he left. He went away to Yemen. So in Yemen, he was working for someone. Then they accused him of stealing something. They took him to the governor of Yemen. Because of the time, so I'll finish the story next week, inshallah. It was waiting for the story to be finished. I'll finish it next time, inshallah. I'll finish the kutub, the questions to finish the kutub. Okay, quick, inshallah, ta'ala. The question I'm going to ask, does the Ash'aris believe Allah above the creation? But if they say yes, then? What do they mean when they say Allah is above the creation? With his essence. You're right, but you have to understand because they do say we believe Allah is above the. But they say above, meaning when you say the gold is above the silver. Doesn't mean in reality, mean in the status. You see which book you want? Oh, yeah, this is QR. Alas, what the mean? Alas, we have 3 books left, more than that. Quick. We have to make it easy. We have the 5 pillars of Islam. Wait, what the? Give the book. All right, what the? Go on, akhi. Yeah. You forgot one, brother. Hey, I forget. I know you know it. Sometimes when you put people on the spot, which one you want? Dawah, khalas. Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar. So the latte. Give it to him, quick. How many pairs of Ihsan there is? You want? I know, but six. No, Iman, Ihsan. No, you have a book already, akhi. You have a book? No. 2, what are they? Naam, sahih. Even though it's 1 pillar, but that is 2. Naam, and ta'bud Allah ka'annaka tarah, this 1. Fa'in lam takun tarah, fa'inna huwa yarak, that's 2. You're right, yeah. There's no da'ud da'wa. Okay, in every 65 years. No, I will always give you an answer. Yeah. I was going to ask you, when Ramadan falls twice in 1 year?
Every 65 years.
Yeah, how then? Okay, how? Because if you could, if you, بعض الأحيان رمضان يقع في 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 العام مرتين في السنة مرتين ها كيف how
because every year 10 days less
no no but how this year when it happens in which month December. You're right mashallah January and December correct yeah mashallah January and December mashallah what year but the غزوة of Badr occurred متى وقعت معركة البدر الكبرى
رمضان
you want to take a book إن شاء الله لا خلاص no what date of رمضان no you خلاص because كتب the date of رمضان متى what date anyone knows date of رمضان 17 17 of رمضان what year ها إيش no you have to one يا أخي you can't do ten ثاني you're right second year تعايز الكتاب؟ خلاص ما شاء الله. You can give it to a brother. You take it as a gift for you. Give it to the brother. Our brother give it to him. As a gift. نعم. The battle of Badr occurred in the 17th of Ramadan, the second year of Hijra. What year? متى شرع الحج؟ What year the Hajj was legislated? Yeah. نعم ما شاء الله. هيا تفضل. نايف. عفواً يا أخوة سوري because it's time for fire عيش أبا we're gonna finish soon one left I'll give it to أخوات because you know we forgot about them and then I'll give it this book to one of them who answered that about the Sunnah one give it to them just give it tell them one take it خلاص بارك الله فيكم وصلى الله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وسلم سليماً كثيراً